And our word for today on this Tuesday of the first week in ordinary time, and our word for today is authority. Authority is our word for today. Our reading from the first book of Samuel, chapter 1. Hannah rose after a meal at Shiloh and presented herself before the Lord. At the time, Eli the priest was sitting on a chair near the doorpost of the Lord's temple. In her bitterness, she prayed to the Lord, weeping copiously, and she made a vow, promising, O Lord of hosts, if you look with pity on the misery of your handmaid, if you remember me and do not forget me, if you give your handmaid a male child, I will give him to the Lord for as long as he lives. Neither wine nor liquor shall he drink, and no razor shall ever touch his head. As she remained long at prayer before the Lord, Eli watched her mouth, for Hannah was praying silently, though her lips were moving. Her voice could not be heard. Eli, then thinking her drunk, said to her, How long will you make a drunken show of yourself? Sober up from your wine. It isn't that, my lord, Hannah answered. I'm an unhappy woman. I have had neither wine nor liquor. I was only pouring out my troubles to the Lord. Do not think your handmaid a ne'er-do-well. My prayer has been prompted by my deep sorrow and misery. Eli said, Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant what you have asked of him. She replied, Think kindly of your maidservant, and left. She went to her quarters, ate and drank with her husband, and no longer appeared downcast. Early the next morning they worshipped before the Lord, and then returned to their home in Ramah. When Elkanah had relations with his wife Hannah, the Lord remembered her. She conceived, and at the end of her term bore a son whom she called Samuel, since she had asked the Lord for him. Our responsorial psalm from the first book of Samuel, chapter 2. My heart exalts in the Lord, my Savior. My heart exalts in the Lord. My horn is exalted in my God. I have swallowed up my enemies. I rejoice in my victory. The bows of the mighty are broken, while the tottering gird on strength. The well-fed hire themselves out for bread, while the hungry batten on spoils. The barren wife bears 7 sons, while the mother of many languishes. The Lord puts to death and gives life. He casts down to the netherworld. He raises up again. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He humbles. He also exalts. He raises the needy from the dust, from the dung heap. He lifts up the poor to seat them with nobles and make a glorious throne their heritage.
Alleluia, alleluia. Receive the word of God, not as the word of men, but as it truly is the word of God. Alleluia, alleluia. Our holy gospel today is from Mark chapter 1. Jesus came to Capernaum with his followers, and on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and taught. The people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. In their synagogue was a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Jesus rebuked him and said, Quiet, come out of him. The unclean spirit convulsed him, and with a loud cry came out of him. And all were amazed and asked one another, What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. His fame spread everywhere throughout the whole region of Galilee.
And our word for today, authority. Authority, our word for today. Our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading. These he shared at his general audience on September the 28th of 2022. It's significant that the first miracle performed by Jesus in Mark's gospel is an exorcism. In the synagogue at Capernaum, he delivers a man from the devil, freeing him from the false image of God that Satan has been suggesting since the beginning. That of a God who does not want our happiness. The possessed man in that passage of the gospel knows that Jesus is God, but this does not lead him to believe in him. In fact, he says, Have you come to destroy us? Many people, even Christians, think the same thing. That is, that Jesus may well be the Son of God, but they doubt that he wants our happiness. Indeed, some fear that taking his proposal seriously, the one Jesus proposes to us, means ruining our lives, mortifying our desires, our strongest aspirations. These thoughts sometimes creep up inside us, that God asks too much of us. We fear that God asks too much of us, that he doesn't really love us. Instead, in our first encounter, we saw that the sign of the encounter with the Lord is joy. When I encounter the Lord in prayer, I become joyful. Each one of us becomes joyful, a beautiful thing. Sadness or fear, on the other hand, are signs of distance from God. Each one of us becomes joyful, a beautiful thing. Sadness or fear, on the other hand, are signs of distance from God. Again, our word for today, authority. Jesus has come that we might have life and that we might have it in abundance. And in fact, brothers and sisters, that we might be free. Now we see in our gospel reading today, as our Holy Father points out, an exorcism in the Gospel of Mark chapter 1, an actual possession which is clearly defined and clearly laid out in the explanation of our gospel today. And so we can kind of wrap our minds around. An evil spirit has moved in, has taken possession of a person, controls them in many ways, and they conduct themselves in evil ways, and they're trapped and they're imprisoned. And an exorcist comes forward, and by the grace and power of Jesus Christ, through the sacraments of the church, that individual can be made free, can be freed of that spirit, and no longer have them dwelling in them. That is an absolute freedom. It's a true freedom. We see it throughout the scriptures in various accounts of various individuals, but always with the same result. When the Lord Jesus approached them, they become free. Even when the followers of Jesus approach them, they become free. But there is a freedom beyond exorcism. There's a freedom and also a slavery that isn't quite exorcism, that's a little harder to define. Either through doing things that become very familiar to us, as we would say familiar spirits, that familiar conduct, those habitual sins, those things that we've allowed into our lives and we have a very difficult time ushering them out, or just our own weaknesses, our own behavior, and of course, influences of the evil one. He has come to kill, to steal, and destroy. He is a liar and a murderer from the beginning, Jesus says. He is real, and those who serve him are real. But at the end of the day, what the Lord wants for each of us is freedom, and by his authority, we too can be free. It was by the authority of Jesus that this man was set free from the demonic presence that existed in him. So again, are we demon-possessed? I doubt that I'm talking to anybody who's demon-possessed, but what I am saying is we have our own habitual sins that have put us in a kind of slavery. We've allowed ourselves to be affected, as our Holy Father says at the end, each one of us becomes joyful, a beautiful thing. Sadness or fear, on the other hand, are signs of distance from God. Sadness, fear, anxiety, all of those things are some sign of a distance between us and God in some particular part of our lives. Nothing to be paranoid about, but something to be aware of so that we can wipe those areas clean and allow the authority of Christ to operate in our lives in those particular areas by his authority. And by his authority, brothers and sisters, we can come before the throne of our Father asking for the intercession of Jesus Christ in our lives for those areas that we have allowed ourselves to become imprisoned, to become slaves to particular behaviors, and ask that the Lord would make us free. Let freedom ring out today. Let us be free because Jesus has come to make us free. And the scripture tells us when the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Are you free indeed? If you are not free indeed, then grasp on to that freedom that the Lord has for each of us today by his own power, by his grace. Jesus came to Capernaum with his followers, and on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and taught. The people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes and the Pharisees. Brothers and sisters, this is the authority of Jesus that he has shared with the members of his church and in a particular ordained way with our bishops and with our priests. available to each and every one of us in the sacrament of reconciliation. Let us go to confession and be made free. Let us at this moment confess our sins and our eager desire to take them to the sacrament of confession and be made free again by the authority of Jesus. Authority, our word for today. And that authority, just again, just to circle back around, that authority Jesus shared when he said to Peter, "You are a rock, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against her. Whose sins you forgiven are forgiven. Those held bound are held bound." Those gifts have been shared through the priesthood in the Catholic Church. Take advantage of that. That is Jesus' authority in that confessional, awaiting to forgive you your sin. Authority, our word for today.